We want to keep moving so we can get to the main event and to our incredible guest speaker today. Our platform topic is the fate of food, what we'll eat in a bigger, hotter, smarter world, with Professor Amanda Little. Amanda Little is a professor of journalism at Vanderbilt University. She's visiting us this weekend from Tennessee. She's the author of The Fate of Food, and she's also the author of a book called Power Trip, the story of America's love affair with energy. She's written about food, energy, the environment, and technology for publications, including The New York Times, The Washington Post, The New Yorker, Bloomberg, Wired, and Rolling Stone. She's interviewed figures ranging from Barack Obama to Lindsey Graham. Amanda Little was also on the MSNBC series, What's Eating America, which some of our members had the pleasure of seeing her and being surprised that we actually had her as a speaker. So we really feel like we're ahead of the times, that we already have her coming here to speak, and she's just been recently on MSNBC. So we're so happy to have Amanda Little here, and please help me in welcoming her.
I'm really impressed with your lectern, because it is automatic. And I'm usually bending way over. Look at this. Oh, standing up straight. It feels great. So this is such an honor and a pleasure. Thank you so much for having me here. Monica and Maggie and Sarah, really such a great community. I was born not far from here. And lived in Manhattan until I was five. Grew up in Washington, D.C., lived in the city in Brooklyn for about 12 years before I then moved to Nashville, Tennessee. And every time I land on the tarmac of LaGuardia Airport, all my cells sort of rearrange in harmony with the chaos and all the marvels of this city. I just love being here, and I'm more inclined than ever to try to convince my husband and family that we need to move back here so I can become a member and come here every Sunday and be a part of a community with aligned values. Nothing is more important right now than to find your people and make connections and work at the grassroots to build and unify around a great vision of progress. So thank you for inviting me here to share my story. This book is about climate change. I'm a bit of an imposter in the food space. I've been writing about the environment and technology for, the better part of 25 years or so. And I really landed in food and food politics and, food strategies for food production because it's a topic that people care so much about. And it's certainly something that I care about as a consumer and as a parent. And having grown up in a household where food was really a proxy for love, my mom was a little bit, restrained in her affirmation verbally of her children, but she was very generous with cream and butter and sauces and delicious flavors. And it's a tough topic when we think about how many pressures there are on food production, how many problems there are with the way we grow food, with the existing existing agriculture, and with all the kind of pressures coming online. So I know that it's a topic near and dear to many of your hearts. And again, I come at it a bit from the outside as an investigative journalist, certainly as an eater, but not as a food activist and not as someone who is particularly virtuous in my eating habits. We'll get to that. There's a lot of good news about what's happening in food production and progress in building resilient, climate-resilient food systems and moving towards sustainability. But I have to take you through some of the kind of harrowing realities at first, and then we'll sort of get to some of the good news. The global population is expected to increase to nearly 10 billion people by mid-century. I know you've heard that. 9.7 billion, I believe, is the number, according to current growth rates. That's in 30 years, moving from about 7.5 billion today. A lot of the populations are moving into urban areas. Diets are shifting among these growing populations toward more protein-intensive and environmentally intensive diets. Meanwhile, arable land is decreasing. The International Panel on Climate Change has predicted a 2 to 6% decline in global crop yields every decade going forward due to climate pressures. The fine print in, I believe it was a 2015 report, said that by mid-century, the world may reach a threshold of global warming beyond which current agricultural practices can no longer support large human civilizations. And I, my brother is a climate scientist, and he walked me through that passage, and I memorized it, and was just really struck by that. As someone who's been following climate for a long time, and I began to sort of explore this topic around 2015, interviewed some scientists, one of whom said this: the main way that most, and NGO leaders and so on, the main way that most people will experience climate change is through its impact on food. Jerry Hatt, which again was surprising to me as a reporter and a journalist exploring this, because we hear so much about displaced populations, about flooding, about fires, about the way that region-specific traumas will affect populations, but because food networks are so integrated and so global, there's impacts that can occur in one region that will affect the food supply in another region. Jerry Hatfield, a scientist at the USDA, said it to me this way: the single biggest threat of climate change is the collapse of food systems. For most of us, this is pretty abstract, right? I live right down the block from a supermarket that's open 7 days a week, carries 52,000 food options. It doesn't seem to me like there's much of an immediate threat to my own food supply. If anything, we as a culture are more concerned about an oversupply of calories in our diets than an undersupply of food. But climate disruptions have been very real and immediate for many producers around the world. Just this past summer, it was in 17 states, I believe, in the Midwest, weren't able to plant corn and soy, not because of heat and drought, which we know was a huge problem for producers in California, around the California drought, but because of too much rain. Because they couldn't get the equipment into the field to actually plant the crops because of these rain bomb events that were, saturating the soil and making it hard to plant. The pressures coming from climate change on food producers and food systems are really varied and diverse, which makes this a kind of very interesting story to explore, but also a kind of difficult one to explain. I put together this little montage of news clips that you can listen to. For
there's an olive oil shortage halfway around the world. Morning Insider Minister Sully delves into this shortage and how your taste buds could be affected right here in Chicago.
Martino Restaurant puts up close to 10,000 meals a week, but in his kitchen, Chef John Coletta is stocking up to avoid the shortage of a key ingredient.
Italian extra virgin olive oil, 100%. You're going to be challenged to find it. Production is down by 57%.
A severe winter in 2018 and a massive bacterial infestation are crippling Italy's olive trees.
The annual harvest is underway, but winemakers in France's famous Chablis region are worried. For the second year in a row, production has dropped, and vineyards like Bonon Ponson of Domaine Ponson Vineyard say climate change is to blame.
It's incredibly stressful.
Frogtown Brewery's Mike Boss says much of that stress comes from having to hunt for critical ingredients like hops. Hops are what give beer its flavor and aroma. Most of the country's hops are grown in Washington, Oregon, and Idaho, states that have suffered increasingly severe droughts in recent years.
A citrus shortage is growing in Florida. A tree-killing bacteria is wiping out the state's famous orange groves. At least 90% of the trees are infected, and orange production is plummeting.
Next time you go to the grocery store, don't be surprised if you have trouble finding sweet Georgia peaches. Nearly 80% of the state's peach crop has been wiped out because of the weather.
The rising cost of vanilla, sending a chill down the spine of ice cream makers. A worldwide crop shortage means that the extract is now more expensive than silver.
Scientists at Lawrence Livermore National Lab predict that climate change will bring hotter weather and cause a 40% drop in California avocado production over the next 3 decades.
I assume there used to be trees here.
Yes, there were trees here.
He's cut down 51,000 almond trees in the past 16 months because he can't afford to water them.
We've lost between a third and half because of dry conditions. The result is that some prices will have to rise. The limited maize crop is causing problems for the cattle breeder. He's already had to feed his livestock the harvest that was meant for the winter.
An invader in Central America has the U.S. government getting involved. The aggressor? A coffee plant fungus. It's called coffee rust, and it's caused more than $1 billion in damage, especially to the plants which grow high-end specialty beans. The fungus is driving up some coffee prices here in the U.S., but the bigger concern is the devastation it's causing Latin American coffee farmers.
So, drought, heat, flooding, superstorms, invasive insects and bacterial blights, weather volatility and shifting seasons, warm winters followed by freeze events, like this image here of frozen apple blossoms at a farm I visited in Wisconsin in just 5 minutes overnight because the weather dropped down to freezing after there'd been an early bloom. A normal freeze event followed an early bloom, wiped out $2 million of apple crops for a small-scale producer in Wisconsin, and I went to try to understand those impacts. So this is a really vast and varied story. As I began to research it, the thread that connected it all was this: climate change is becoming something we can taste, right? This is a kitchen table issue. And it's becoming so in a very literal sense, and also we're seeing it become so politically, a little late to the game, or a lot late to the game. And our challenge going forward is twofold. We have to solve the existing problems with industrial agriculture while we begin to prepare for the pressures ahead. What's interesting about agriculture, unlike the other major industries that are major contributors to climate change, agriculture is uniquely vulnerable, right? So it's actually driving a lot of the climate problem. Somewhere roughly 20% of greenhouse gas emissions are produced by agriculture, by food producers. It's very environmentally intensive, certainly especially the large-scale food production systems that have evolved in the past century. And so we have kind of the challenge of reforming the problems with existing agriculture and building resilience and preparing for these sort of pressures to come. I want to walk you through just a few quick statistics about agriculture to show you how sort of environmentally intensive it is. 70% of the world's fresh water flows to farms. So when there are disruptions in hydrology, which is really what climate change is, there's too much water in some regions, too little water in others. So we have major drought stresses, of course, in a lot of producers. Any kind of water disruptions that end up having huge impacts on food producers. A third of the world's grain goes to feeding livestock. So what happens in the field then really affects meat production, and the systems are very integrated. The other third another third of grain production goes to ethanol, which is not even something we physically consume. And we can get into that. But meat is the big thing. I know many of you have heard about some of these emerging sort of plant-based meat alternatives. This is in part why. Each year, humanity consumes 160 million tons of seafood, 50 billion chickens, 5 billion cattle, pigs, goats, and sheep. In the last 50 years, global population has doubled, meat consumption has tripled. Right? So again, what's happening, these pressures are really not just about more people, but changing diets and increasingly meat-intensive and protein-intensive diets. So I, like many people, as I began to learn about this, really thought, I'm going to become a virtuous eater. And I read Michael Pollan and I read Alice Waters, and I, in fact, knew Michael Pollan through my own reporting experiences, had interviewed him a couple of times. He came through town, and I wanted to show him a really beautiful backyard garden because, you know, he's so good at it. And this is what happened to me. You know, started out looking pretty good, and then by sort of early July, the entire thing had grown into a unified organism. There are zucchini and that are the size of raccoons down in there, and I have been ever since, and my kids have gotten a little better at helping me out, but making attempts to become a sort of virtuous backyard gardener, and to significantly cut down on meat consumption. I am a failed vegan, a lapsed vegetarian, and I'm working very hard to cut meat entirely out of my diet. But I grew up, as I said, in this household where, you know, my mother not only lavished me with wonderful sauces and so on, but she believed that anything but red meat was vegetable matter, basically, chicken and fish included. So, you know, I culturally come from a very meat-intensive diet, and it has been really difficult for me to move into vegetarian and veganism, despite the fact that I know that it matters. All of this made me ask this question. How are we going to fix the problems in our food system, past and present and future, if we can't necessarily rely on a critical mass of backyard farming vegetarians to do it from the ground up? And I do think that we need huge support and encouragement for people to reform their diets. I also know that we have to be practical and realistic about how inaccessible a lot of the sustainable food solutions are, sustainable food products are, how expensive they are. There's been a lot of concern about elitism in the sustainable food movement. It's very hard for many of us to get to Whole Foods or to afford farmers markets and so on. So I wanted to look not only at what do we do individually, but also how do we reform the system? How do we build a 100% sustainable food system? And I asked this question of Michael Pollan when he came through town. I said, if we can't, you know, all follow your food rules, or we don't have the time and resources to do so, how do we do this across the board? And how do we do this in emerging economies where they're moving toward Western and more meat-intensive diets? And he basically said, I don't know, someone should write that book. And so here I am 5 years later having attempted to do so. I traveled to 13 countries and 15 states over the course of 4 years, asking questions about this. How will we build resilience and sustainability in our food systems? Because food webs are so interconnected, we import more than half of all the fruits in this country, about 40% of our vegetables. So this had to be a global story. And again, connecting all these threads was difficult, but certainly fascinating. I went from those small apple farms in Wisconsin to maize fields in Kenya to massive fish farms in Norway and computerized foodscapes in Shanghai. I looked at solutions old and new, right? There's an interesting sort of binary discussion going on around food and sustainability. On the one side, you have a lot of high-tech folks, Bill Gates and others in Silicon Valley, saying, the time is ripe to reinvent food, which was actually a quote from Bill Gates. And then you have a lot of the advocates of sustainable food saying, I would like my food de-invented, thank you very much. Can we please go back to pre-industrial agriculture? I want chicken coops, I want backyard farming, I want chemicals taken out of my food, and so on. And as a person observing this from the outside, I wondered, can we do both, right? Can we bring state-of-the-art technology to this problem while also protecting food traditions and food quality and improving food quality? I wanted to introduce you to a few of the people I met. We don't have time for me to dwell too much on this, but hopefully in Q&A we can kind of get into more detail. But a few of the people who showed me what I call a third way in this book, The Fate of Food. they showed me the possibility of using technology not to compete with sustainable food systems, but to support and elevate them. Jorge Herrod is one of the first innovators that I met who really showed me the possibility of this kind of third way for sustainable food production and climate resilience. He grew up in Lima, Peru. His grandparents farmed 200 acres outside of the city. And he worked on the farm growing up. He ended up going to Stanford to get a degree in electrical engineering, teamed up with an AI roboticist, artificial intelligence and roboticist, who built the world's first robotic weeder, which that sounded kind of cool and exciting. And it is relevant to climate change. I'll explain why. And I went to take a look at the maiden voyage of this robot in the fields, and I was expecting sort of C-3PO glittering in the sun with pincers and so on, and this is what I got instead. It was this sort of hoop skirt behind a tractor that was moving down the field at 12 miles an hour, standard tractor speed. And underneath there is a bank of 28 cameras that use computer vision to distinguish between the crop and the weed. And it deploys with sniper-like precision a tiny jet of concentrated fertilizer onto the baby weed that can't sustain that intensity of fertilizer or herbicide, annihilates the weed but spares the plant. Within 2 weeks, this robot was applying herbicides with 95% more efficiency than current herbicide practices, right? So glyphosate, which is, you know, a carcinogen, Roundup, and so on, is deployed usually by broadcast spraying. It's just dumped across the field, the plants we eat absorb it, and so do the weeds die, the plants don't. This cuts that down by 95%. You can see how precise it gets. The robot actually spared the crop in the middle and hit the pigweed, which is the weed surrounding it. What it also means is plant by plant rather than field by field farming in the future. So they're applying this technology not just to herbicide, but to fertilizers, pesticides, fungicides, and so on. When the machines can treat each plant individually, they can actually bring different or grow different crops together, right? So it's diversity, intercropping, restoring diversity to those massive monocropped fields we see in the Midwest. And that is the principle of agroecology. It's the principle of sustainable food production, is you want to move away from single crop farming and bring companion planting and diversity back into fields. And he said it to me this way, my robots are not here to compete with nature, they're here to help protect it. There are problems, of course, with heavily mechanized agriculture. This is not a flawless solution, but it is moving in a direction of resilience, of radical chemical efficiency, of much less energy intensive and chemically intensive agriculture, and more diversity. This, whoever saw the MSNBC show, they were looking at vertical farming. This is at a farm in Newark, New Jersey, not far from here, where they're doing indoor cropping. They're growing plants, high nutrient greens mostly, but also berries and cucumbers, 30 to 40% faster than they grow in field, using about 90 to 90% less water. The plants are in an aeroponic system. The roots dangle in a mist of nutrients. And they're, of course, immune to all the pressures of storm systems and drought and so on. And it doesn't make sense if you live in Berkeley, California, or somewhere where you have access to a lot of rich soil and mild seasons. But there is a huge amount of investment in these systems, particularly in the Middle East and places where there's a lot of problem with soil fertility and certainly water. So these companies have been exploding. These indoor vertical farm companies have been exploding. They can produce in the space of a soccer goal what it takes in field to produce in the space of a football field. So amazing efficiencies, zero chemical additives in terms of herbicides and so on, high nutrient, high quality foods that are much more environmentally efficient. And we can talk about the water sources, but this gives you a sense of different approaches to this. Energy is energy intensive, and we can certainly talk about how they're addressing that. But there are vertical systems and there are tray systems. This is a fascinating journey I took to explore the meat and meat alternatives that are emerging. As I mentioned, the meat intensive diets have become so environmentally burdensome. Uma Valetti is doing cell-based meats, which is a very different thing than the plant-based meats we've heard of from Beyond Meat and Impossible Foods. Those are products that have, I think you've probably heard about the Beyond Meat IPO, you know, which increased in value 600% in a week, I believe. Anyway, plant-based meats are becoming very, very popular from an investment standpoint. This guy is a cardiologist who's growing cell-based meats or cultured meats. They're not on the market yet, but again, present this pretty profoundly either eerie or exciting or both opportunity to bring massive efficiency to the way that we produce meats. They biopsy cells from the muscle tissue of an animal, let those cells replicate outside of the animal in what's called a bioreactor, harvest the cells and produce meat that is cellularly identical to animal meat, but without the massive amount of waste that is associated with animal meat, and of course the problems with humane treatment and slaughter of animals. The reason why I actually pursued this is because I had interviewed the CEO of Tyson Foods, which slaughters 2.3 billion animals a year, and they were investing in this company, among others. 3 years ago, there were 4 cell-based meat companies in the world. There are now 41. It is an area of enormous activity. They're doing cell-based fish, cell-based chicken, and so on. When I went to Uma's laboratory, he's showing me the on his screen there, the muscle tissue that's growing in the bioreactor. Freshly harvested from the bioreactor was a lump of duck breast meat that I consumed, having signed my life away in his laboratory. I was vaguely concerned that I would sort of grow feathers and start quacking after I ate the stuff, but it tasted exactly like meat. And it's actually safer in terms of bacterial contamination and so on. Again, identical on a molecular and cellular level to conventional or animal-based meats. These just give you a sense of some of these emerging solutions or these emerging products. This is a cell-based chicken coming out of this is a Memphis Meat. This is the Impossible Meat product, which is now in Burger King, White Castle, Shake Shack, and so on. And that is the duck breast that was being fried in a pan that I later consumed. I'm going to very quickly, because I know we're out of time, talk about some areas of innovation that I explored that are seem irrelevant to food production but are essential to it. This is water tech. Blue tech is another way of thinking about it. This is in Israel. There are a number of different approaches to building drought-proof water supplies. We remember that 70% statistic, 70% of fresh water goes to food production. So without drought-proof water supply, we have no food. Again, there are these sort of radically efficient approaches like those indoor farming systems that use much, much less water, but that is only a tiny fraction of our real food supply. And Israel is working on recycling sewage, believe it or not, which is now becoming a reality in California, Southern California, where there's a lot of drought. Also desalination, which is drawing in ocean water, stripping out the salt, and essentially ending up using reverse osmosis membranes with water that's every bit as pure as what you buy in a bottle. This is, be prepared for gross, is this recycled sewage plant that I visited in Orange County, California. And this was the sewage that had been stripped out of water that 45 minutes later came flowing out of a tap and tasted crystal clean. but quite literally, a lot of the energy in Tennessee, the way that we produce water is pulled out of the Cumberland River, which is loaded with sewage and industrial effluent, and it's treated with chemicals. So in a sense, this is a way of removing impurities mechanically rather than chemically. It's sort of like organic water, weirdly, as opposed to chemically treated water. But the upshot is hyper pure water that has been stripped of certainly any sort of particulate matter, but also pathogens and so on. And it's, again, a solution that solves many of the problems, which is, you know, really unsavory water to begin with, and building a drought-proof water supply. This guy is building smart water networks that address leaks and bursts in pipe systems. We lose about 30 to 40% of all the water that's distributed in cities in worldwide because of these ancient sort of aging water distribution systems. So increasingly the future of agriculture depends on not only drought-proof water supply, but also much more effective, smarter distribution systems. So many different folks I met along the way of this journey who taught me about different approaches to dairy. This is a flora-based dairy product. It's sort of like cell-based meats, but for dairy and eggs. This is an AI robot in fish farms in Norway that's helping significantly reduce the environmental impact of fish farming and improve the quality of the farmed fish and take pressure off of wild systems. Drones, I'm sure you're familiar with, advanced breeding techniques that help plants learn to be climate resilient, to grow in more hostile conditions, higher heat and drought conditions. This is 3D printed foods. This was a sort of very end of my research. I went to the US Army Natick Research Laboratory and ate some food pellets that came out of a 3D printer. I don't really think that's the future of food, but it's part of an attempt to get much more personalized, more efficient, low carbon food options for soldiers in the field, and that may become relevant to certain consumers who are interested in Soylent and these other kind of whiz-bang food replacement options. I am a nostalgic person. I love great flavors. I love my grandmother's casseroles. A lot of the work I did was going to permaculture farms, looking at the ways we can revive ancient plants that evolved over thousands of years to deal in high stress conditions. This is at the Land Institute in Kansas. This is kernza, a type of wheat that evolved to grow 10-foot roots. So that the plant can tap deep, deep down below water resources. It's not adapted to modern growing conditions, but can be with new breeding techniques, adapting ancient plants to modern growing conditions and populations. All of this is part of, I think, a very hopeful, and I know it's a little jarring, but a very hopeful story that human innovation that combines old and new approaches to food production can redefine sustainability on a grand scale. And I'm gonna pause there, and I don't know if we have more than 5 minutes or so for Q&A, but I appreciate your patience and your interest in my work, and thank you for having me here. Great question. So the cost of, let's talk about the meat thing, because if we really think about what's the number one thing you can do to reduce your carbon impact as a consumer, as an eater, food waste is way up there, and I have a chapter on food waste, and it's fascinating and concerning, but also a lot of really interesting progress. Probably the lowest cost problem to tackle, but the hardest from a kind of shift in consciousness standpoint. The meat story is very high cost, and the AI story is also, some of the AI technologies are very high cost. But let's look at meat, because a lot of us are interested in how soon these products are going to be on the market and how viable and competitive they will be relative to, you know, the T-bone steak that you get at your local market. 3 years ago, about a pound of this cell-based meat was roughly $100,000. What I ate, which was 2 ounces of, you know, lab of cell-grown duck breast, was about $600. So it's not on the market. It's still very high cost. But the enormous drop in cost. I mean, it was, by the way, the most expensive meal I will ever eat, and possibly the most dangerous. But I survived it fine. So the costs are coming down very dramatically, right? 3 years, that kind of decline in cost is pretty dramatic. Now, the cost of producing conventional meats is increasing, in large part because meat is so water intensive, because the grains that we feed livestock are becoming more difficult to grow, and not year by year, but over time. So as conventional meat producers deal with much higher cost for water and much higher cost for grain, and as the cost of these meat alternatives comes down, it will be at or below current meat prices. There's no question about it. Will it be 3 years from now, 5 years from now, 10 years from now? That's hard to know. And will these products be available? They won't come onto the market until they are cost competitive. Will they be available to us? And, you know, again, in 2 years or 3 years or 5 years, very few of the producers are giving an exact timeline on it. But the key is economies of scale, right? Nothing will be or available to consumers until it's affordable. In terms of the AI robot, the cost challenges there are a little bit more tricky. When you have that kind of hyper-sophisticated technology on the market, it's both a blessing and a curse for a farmer, right? Because for example, the farmer who was using the pilot wheat robot had a reduction of about 60% in his herbicide costs, which are his highest cost for his inputs. So it's a major saving for him, but he has to lease the machine, and he has to have the wherewithal to figure out how to fix it if it breaks, which is a difficult thing to do. 3 years after that Blue River Technology, which is that company that Jorge Herod's company, was founded, it was bought by John Deere for $305 million. A bit of a Faustian deal, right? Because John Deere is this old legacy ag brand, but they have 10,000 distributors around the world. They know how to produce very reliable machines, and they can scale very quickly. And it can be then a kind of machine that is leased to farmers rather than sold, and then maintained by mechanics. Again, it has to make sense financially for farmers. The problem is that as these conditions become more volatile, the cost of agriculture and the risks become higher. So the solutions, while they are costly, will eventually become less costly than the risks, if that makes sense. Yes.
I enjoyed your presentation as well.
Thank you.
I know that with the industrialization of farming, fewer farmers, fewer percent of the population, and fewer people farm. So I'm wondering, with all this new tech, was there any do you have any chance to look at what it would do who still work in the food industries? Would it create more jobs?
Yeah. That's a great question, and I'm glad you brought it up. So there's been a huge problem with consolidation of farms, right? And there's no question at all that the farming population in the U.S. in particular, but globally, is aging. I think the median age is something like 63, and there's fewer and fewer. I think there are now 2 million farmers as opposed to what was once 20, 30 million farmers or something. So, it's a definite story of consolidation and contraction and a lot of concerns about aging food producers. What's interesting about all this new stuff, in part, the median age of Arrow Farms, which is that company I visited in Newark, New Jersey, or Plenty, which is another vertical farm, is probably 28. These are urban farmers who almost never and have never put their hands in the dirt. They're architects, they're programmers, they're mechanical engineers, they're not hands in the dirt farmers. What's happening is a diversification of the skills brought to bear. Now, in no way do I think we're moving to food systems that will not involve growing food in soil, rehabilitating soil and building up soil health is going to be crucial to a climate safe future. Soil is the most important carbon reserve place for carbon sequestration on planet Earth, even more than trees. So restoring soil health and moving to sustainable practices on mid-size and large scale farms is crucial. We will always have hands in the dirt farmers and livestock producers. I mean, these guys who are doing this kind of disruptive meat technology don't think that they're going to completely displace animal meat production. They're trying to address the enormous growth in meat consumption and so forth. A lot of the people who are coming in to develop these sort of alternative or, these kind of, new food startups and smart ag and climate resilient startups are much younger, much more diverse, very different demographic than the folks who are farmers as we know it. Food systems and local food webs and urban farms and peri-urban farms are more important than ever. So again, this is not about we're either going to have massive industrial farms or, farm scrapers in cities. We're going to have networks of small and mid-sized farms, hands-in-the-dirt farmers, livestock producers who are doing managed and rotational grazing, conservation agriculture, but also some of this much more high-tech stuff. A lot of the young people who come in, a lot of the job growth in sustainable food production, we'll be pulling in all this young, all these new kind of young farmers who are, again, maybe not working with their hands in the dirt. If Thomas Edison were alive today, I'm pretty certain he would be working on this problem. How do you build food security in the 21st century? It is, an enormous engineering challenge. It is an enormous ethical challenge above all. It calls on us as consumers to think about, how we consume, how much we waste, what we decide, whether we can cut meat out of our diets or shift to alternatives, what we're comfortable with. It's also a call to action for a lot of young people who are figuring out their career paths. And a lot of the audiences I've been talking to are young people who are in tech, but they want to go into, food and climate issues. So yes, it's addressing both job losses in, for example, conventional livestock production, but job gains in some of these emerging kind of disruptive areas of innovation. I saw a bunch of other hands, but is that we have?
We're
out. Okay.
So, but.